prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, oh. Hey. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will win.
Good morning, church. I want to welcome all of you here today. It is great seeing you present, and even though we can't see you at home, we're glad you're watching today, and we're grateful that you've joined in with us for this very special service. We are so blessed today to have Don Gatewood preaching for us. Don is no stranger around Forest Burdette. Everyone knows and loves Don, and he has served this church so well, and I'm excited about his ministry with us today. So as we gather together here today, I'm so grateful you're here, grateful you're watching, and let's join our hearts in a moment of prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, how thankful we are this day to begin our day with you, to have this time of worship, to have this time of sharing, to be able to come together in the name of Christ and to lift up your wonderful name high above all others. We are so grateful, Lord, for this day and what it will bring. And I ask in the name of Christ that you will open our hearts, whether we are present or whether we're watching from home or somewhere else. We ask that you will open our hearts, that we will be receptive to everything you are going to show us this day. Thank you, thank you, thank you. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Good morning, everybody. So, there we go. So how are y'all doing this morning? It's good to see everybody out here today and see those smiling eyes anyway. And it's good that everybody is watching with us at home or wherever that you are. Today we have another story that I could possibly sing about. It's Zacchaeus, or however you want to say his name. And he was a tax collector, a guy that most people didn't like because you had to give him your money, but not just because of that. He wasn't a good tax collector. He tried to get as much extra money as people from people that he could. And so nobody liked him at all. He was a bad guy. So I kind of start to wonder why he was so excited to see Jesus coming that day. He must have heard stories about Jesus, but if he truly was happy with what he was doing, would he really care to go see what Jesus was about? But no, he heard about Jesus, and he ran, and he saw that there was a crowd, and that there was no way he could ever see Jesus from where he was, because he wasn't very tall. So he finds a tree, and he climbs up just to see Jesus. He doesn't even think he can get to talk to him. He just wants to see him, just wants to see what this man is all about. Well, we know how the story goes. Jesus sees Zacchaeus in the tree. I'm already thinking that something in Zacchaeus is wanting to change. He knows he's not doing what he's supposed to be doing, not living the good life that he's supposed to be living. And when Jesus says, "Zacchaeus, you come down here. I need to go to your house," something changes. Something happens. Because he doesn't just say, "Oh, okay," or no, "my house is too messy," or like, "let's maybe try tomorrow," or no, he says, "come on, and not only can you come to my house, but I'm gonna change right now. I, in front of this whole crowd of people, say, I'm gonna give back not just what I took, but four times more than what I took." And Jesus says, look at this man who has changed. We have come to save the lost. And friends, that's what we're here to do. We're looking for those people out there who's living lives that maybe aren't exactly what they want to be. And they see us doing great things, living good lives, and they're wondering what it is that we have that they don't. So if you see somebody peeking over at your life trying to see what it is that you're doing, maybe invite them over, because it might be their day to change. Let's bow our heads, let's say a prayer. Dear God, thank you so much for helping us to save people around us just by showing your love, just by letting them see your goodness in our lives. God, help us to light the way to you in all the things we do. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Thank you.
Bob and Michael, we appreciate that very much. You're sharing with us a beautiful, beautiful piece of music. As we come to this point in our service, we are going to lift up our joys and concerns. And I want to start off with a joy today, celebrating their 45th wedding anniversary. Coy and Joan, will you give them a round of applause? We're so grateful for 45 years together. What a blessing that is. And Coy, sure good to see you getting around so well now. All right, we also want to lift up Maurice and Billy DeLung's son, Aaron, Major Aaron Lane. He is, of course, going to South Korea for 11 to 12 months. He's being deployed there, so please keep him in your prayers, and I know they will appreciate that very much. Also, Jill Turner's brother, Roy Wheeler, is in need of a double lung transplant. He's currently at home with hospice care, and so we're praying for him that somehow this might be accomplished, that he can live on this earth longer, and so we want to lift up Roy. Also, want to just remind you, let you know that John Mason fell the other day and broke an arm. He's back home from the hospital, but will have to go in sometime this week for surgery on his arm. So please keep John in your prayers. John is still actively preaching at the Polk United Methodist Church. I've known John for many, many years, and I could tell you some stories, but I'm telling you, he's a real blessing in my life, and I want to lift him up today. Also, we've had a prayer request from Thelma Carter for her niece, Denise Webb. She had some surgery this week, so please remember Denise in your prayers. Also, a great report from Shirley Hill. She went back to the oncologist. There's absolutely no cancer there now, and she is doing great, and really wanted to just share that as a way of praising the Lord for the wonderful way in which the Lord is watching over her. Such a great blessing. And also got word that Joe Varian is not doing well, so let's remember Joe in our prayers as well this day. And I wonder if there's any unspoken request today by an uplifted hand. Just say, pray for me or pray with me as I'm praying for others. All right, let's join our hearts in prayer. Almighty God, what a great blessing it is to come before you this day, to give you thanks for the countless blessings of life, to give you thanks for all the times you've been there for us when we needed you so desperately, to give you thanks for the peace that comes in our hearts when we know that we love you and have you as our personal Savior. We ask, Lord, that as we gather here this day, that all of us will take this opportunity, whether we're here in this present room or whether we're at our homes or wherever we may be, that we just will feel your presence in a very real way, and that we will find ourselves drawing near to you in this hour. Lord, thank you for your presence with us wherever we are, and thank you for never letting us down. Today, Lord, we have a number of requests before us, and we do start off with a great joy with Coy and Joan celebrating their 45th wedding anniversary. And we want to lift up Shirley Hill as a word of praise because you have brought her through a difficult time and she is fully healed, and we are grateful for that great report. But Lord, we also have concerns on our hearts, and we want to lift up Maurice and Billy DeLung's son, Aaron, this day as he is being deployed to South Korea. Watch over him in this time of deployment. And may he know your presence with him each and every day. for Jill's brother, Roy Wheeler. We lift him today, asking, Lord, for a miracle in his life, that he might get the lungs that he needs and be able to live long and healthy on this earth. We pray, Lord, for Thelma's niece, Denise Webb, and ask that you will surround her with your loving arms as she recovers from this surgery. And for Joe Varian, please, Lord, watch over Joe in this time. And I just pray, Lord, that your touch will be upon Joe as well. And I ask, Lord, that you will bless all those who have lifted their hands this day, whether it is a personal need or a prayer for someone else. We ask in the name of Christ that you will meet these needs and that you will minister in every situation. And now, Lord, as Don prepares in just a few moments to bring the message, I pray for him this day that you will fill him with your Holy Spirit, that you will touch his life and bless him in a special way as he ministers to all of us. And Lord, thank you for everyone who makes it possible for us to be able to gather for worship, to be able to live stream, to get this out there in ways that we never dreamed possible. And we ask, Lord, that you will guide us and keep us, not only in this day, but every day of our lives. And now may we all join together in that prayer that Jesus taught us to pray when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Today's scripture reading comes from Luke 19, verses 1 through 10. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was so short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, He had gone to be the guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor, and if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Jesus said to him, Today salvation has come to this house because this man, too, is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the host. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
The story of Zacchaeus has been told and preached from many and many a time. Some call him Zacchaeus, some call him Zacchaeus, and I don't know, his best friends might even call him Zach. Whatever the case may be, it tells us a lot about the natural person, the natural man, and Zacchaeus is representative of many of those. It isn't really Zacchaeus that I want to speak to you about today. I want to use one of the most important verses of Scripture. One of the most important in the entire Bible. And that is the purpose for which Jesus came. He only came for one purpose. Can you believe that? The Bible says that all that Jesus said and all that Jesus did, that all the books in the world could not contain those things, both what he said and what he did. But yet in the midst of all that, he was here for a single and solitary mission, and that is to come to seek and to save those that are lost. Now, where are we today in the United States, in this world? If we go back many, many years, now I can go back farther than most of you that are here today, because I was actually sitting at my grandparents' Sunday dinner table when President Roosevelt came on and announced that Pearl Harbor had been bombed. And I remember that in elementary school that we practiced air raid drills. Sometimes they would take us to the basement, and sometimes we would just huddle on the floor of a classroom. There were many, many ways that they used to do that. And we, the people of this country, have been prone to rise to the challenge in many different times. The United States wasn't prepared for war in World War II, and so there were many people that were drafted and joined and went far away to Europe and then also to Japan. And many, many of them suffered the loss of their lives. The country was in great despair, and guess what it really began to do? Pray. Pray. We were in trouble as a people, and so we began to pray. And I remember that there were many great revivals in that particular time. And people were willing to go worship in a church, were willing to go out to tent revivals, and there were even preaching on street corners in that particular time. For what reason? Because people really needed God. I can tell you that, again, that Jesus came for one reason, to seek and to save. And so, as we went through those times, I can remember when I was first saved, November the 3rd, 1963. I went to church that evening. It was a Sunday evening. And I went to church that evening, lost, undone, not knowing Jesus as Lord and Savior. But when the invitation time came, I stepped out. God's Spirit called my heart. And I stepped out and walked down the aisle and gave my heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. I believed with all my heart and soul that night that Jesus died for me, that Jesus died for my sin. And so I came to him to be saved. And later on in early life, I was called to the ministry. And I remember that in about the first 20-some years of ministry, not only did I pastor churches, but went to various churches as an evangelist in revivals. That was a time when people were still in need of the Lord, and people still were looking to him, and spirituality was more popular in that particular time. Parents were teaching their children about God and teaching children about the church and the good things that the church did. And so many of these revivals, there were many, many saved. I remember after one revival, we had a big baptism, and it was in the Elk River, and we baptized 22 that one afternoon in the Elk River. That was after breaking the ice so we could get in the river. And if anybody ever tells you that, oh, I didn't get cold, they probably ought to go back and get baptized again, because it was, brother, it was cold, and I was numb when I got out. So that night we had church at the church I pastored, and there was a lady saved in the church. And guess what? She wanted to be baptized now. This was the same day, 22 in the afternoon, in the church that night. This was now. She wanted to be baptized. So we had to find a place on the creek where the water was deep enough to baptize. So we baptized her about 9:30 that night. And that water was cold too. But the only thing was, when I went in the afternoon, I was prepared. After baptizing that many people, I put on an overcoat so I could at least get some warmth within. But that night, I was totally unprepared for a baptizing, particularly in a creek that was ice cold. But those were, you know, I look back. We talk about good times, and I don't know what you consider good times, but those were times when people were willing to take time out to go serve the Lord, to take time out to worship the Lord. And churches were much, much fuller at that particular time. But as we went from generation to generation to generation to generation, we just went down, down, down spiritually in this country. When I was a child and going to school, guess what we did? We prayed the Lord's Prayer every single morning in school. We said the Pledge of Allegiance every single morning in school. Can't do that anymore. Can't do that anymore. The government says it's an infringement upon the rights of others. But you see, Jesus came to seek and save the lost. Jesus isn't concerned about our politics. Jesus isn't concerned about any of those things. He's concerned with our soul. And Zacchaeus is just one representation in the scripture. One representation. There are many, many more that are given. And it was essential that Jesus could show the people that he could heal, that he could raise people from the dead. And all of the miracles that he performed to show people that he was the Christ. He was the living Christ, the God that could seek and to save. Now, one thing you'll find out that's a little bit curious about Luke, and that is Luke never met Jesus. One of the, I used to read some of the stories, short books in Reader's Digest. And one of them was Lucanius the Physician. And it told the story of Luke, how he lived and the things that he did prior to his coming to a knowledge of Christ. So Luke really was only hearing about Christ. And eventually came to Jerusalem, but Christ had already been crucified at that particular time. And by the way, Luke is not only the writer of Luke, but also the Acts of the Apostles. So he wrote two substantial books in the New Testament. So all of this he gained through the fact of working with disciples, those that follow Christ. Now, you and I are disciples. That's what we are. We are followers of Christ, and we need to fulfill the mission of the church. Now, the mission of the church is not to build buildings and not to do all of the social things that we find that seem to be essential today. But our mission is the same as Jesus. He came to seek and to save the lost. And as his disciples, we are to be concerned about those that are what? Come on now. Lost. And in our being concerned about the lost, people have to see Christ within us. Christ in our living. In our day-to-day walk as we go forth, we are to be witnesses to the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as people see Christ in us, we have a better opportunity to witness to them. We're his witnesses. Go into all the world. Preach the gospel. Preach the gospel for what purpose? For the lost, that they might hear the word of God. I don't know where I might be today. I may not even be alive in the world today, were it not for November 3rd, 1963, when I found Jesus as Savior. And of course, being later called into the ministry, it became more of a responsibility of witnessing to others. But it's not just Ed's responsibility and Jeremy's responsibility and my responsibility to tell people about Jesus. It's your responsibility as well. And we've kind of lost that. We've kind of lost that. I would say almost two-thirds. Now, I'm going to give you just a few statistics, and I'd like for you to pay close attention, if you would. Almost two-thirds of Americans believe the coronavirus is a message from God to humanity to change the way they live. Do you know that all of the great nations of the world, all of them, the empires of the world, became irrelevant, became just another place because they just rotted within? Self-serving, jealous, not honest, neglecting God, neglecting the truth of God, and they just fell into, disrepair. And suddenly they vanished. And these great nations usually lasted about 300 or 400 years. You can go to the book of Daniel and you can kind of get a capsule of what the entire world would be like or become. 35 million Americans who seldom pray or even darken the door of the church have started praying. In trouble again, aren't we? This country is in trouble in a lot of different ways, but people are starting to pray more, because what happens when you can't do something yourself, when you can't overcome something? What do? You try to find a way to overcome. And many, many, many find once again that way is through God. 4 or 5 Americans believe that things are out of control. Are they ever? Are they ever out of control? Only 22% of American men and 33% of the American women, here's women leading the charge again, because if I think about some of the great revivals back in the 40s and the 50s, It seemed that in more cases than not, that it was the woman in the house who came to the Lord and then eventually led her husband to the Lord. That's not a thought, that's a fact. 33% of American women said they depend on Jesus Christ to overcome sin. That's a small part of the entire population. 65% of Americans say that even though everyone sins a little bit, have you ever heard that phrase? Sins a little bit? That most people are good by nature. Now, I want you to tell me, where in the scripture does it say that human nature is good? Where in the scripture does it say that if you do right more than you do wrong, well, you're okay? Where in the scripture does it say that you can be good enough to save yourself? Not in this book. Not in this book. In Romans 23 and 24, it says this: for all have sinned, all, A-L-L, have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely. How? By good living? No. They're justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. Now, startling. 55% of those attending church say they have not had a born-again experience. Now, when you start talking about being born again, people talk about you being fundamentalists that just do what the Bible says and nothing else. Well, in John 3, Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." Born again. Born again. More than 50% of evangelicals, I have trouble with this one, but more than 50% of evangelicals believe there's more than one way to heaven. Now, let me ask you. Well, first I want to just read John 3 again. It says, "Very truly I tell you that no one can see the kingdom of God unless they're born again. But I want to tell you also that to believe that there's more than one way to heaven is to do damage to the cross of Christ. If there was more than one way to go to heaven, then why did Jesus come in the first place? If there was more than one way to go to heaven, why did the cross have to bear our sins, the Christ of the cross? There is one way to God, and that is through Jesus Christ our Lord. And Jesus declared to a man called Nicodemus, rich man that was not only wealthy but very well educated, and he said, Nicodemus, you must be born again. No other way. 75% of church attendees do not believe that sharing their faith is important. You know, I don't doubt that statistic. That's a rough one to listen to. But how many of us ever share our faith? How many of us ever, even with family members, share our love of Christ and our salvation through the cross of Christ, through his death on Calvary. More than half of young people ages 18 to 24 do not believe the Bible is the inspired word of God. And I want to ask you, whose fault is that? Whose fault is that? What are we for? We are for teaching our children. We are for bringing our children up in the right way, in a way that pleases God. Now, Timothy wrote, all scripture, not just a little bit, but all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God, and this is man generically, meaning men and women of God, may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. For every good work. So you can you can dispute all you like about whether the scripture is relevant or not, but the word of God is forever. God gave us his word. Why? That we might be saved. That we can be saved and delivered from our sins and from our transgressions. That we can have godly homes, godly children. So that's our responsibility. Only half of all who teenagers who grew up in a Christian home had regular conversations about God. So that means about half. So we wonder what's wrong in our nation today. And it all boils down to one simple fact. I do believe America has forgotten God. Too many things that are more important. Now, many, many, many centuries before, the writer in the book of Chronicles wrote these words, "When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face again and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven. Then I will forgive them their sin, and then I will heal their land. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayers offered in this place." Offered in this place. So where are we? We're in a time of crisis again. Different kind of crisis from time to time. But through these years, since our last huge crisis in World War II, we have ceased to be a Christian nation, in fact. In other words, we've kind of just lost the way. And the only way that we can get things corrected, and although there are millions of people in the world and in this country, you know how things happen? They happen one person at a time. because in coming to Jesus and seeking pardon and forgiveness of sin, it's one at a time. I can't be saved for my children. They can't be saved for me. We can tell them and tell them of God's love and His mercy and His grace and His peace, His affection for us. But every single individual has to make that decision. Well, last Sunday I had the privilege of trying to sing a song, and the third verse of that song says, "So my brother, if the things that this world gave you leave hungers that won't pass away, my blessed Lord will come and save you if you'll kneel to Him and humbly pray." We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. This hymn of invitation, well, as a matter of fact, this hymn of invitation was being sung the night that I came to Jesus. But it still rings true today. It rings so true that the Reverend Billy Graham, who's passed away a few years ago, sang it in the Crusades, had it sung in the Crusades, because of its true meaning. Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me. And as we sing this song this morning, I want to tell you a couple little things up front. This altar's been sanitized. And if you have a need in your life this morning and you want to turn your life over to Jesus as Lord, you can come and pray. You can find a place. We'll still do social distancing, but you can find a place. And you can either come alone or a family member can come with you. But, you know, we need to, as Christians, we need to obey spiritual laws, and we need to obey civil laws as well. So whether we agree with them or not, the Scripture is always right and always correct. Civil laws are not always right, not always correct, but they are what they are. And in good keeping with good faith, if you need Jesus in your life this morning or in your family, you come while we sing "Just As I Am." All right. If you would, please, just stand while we sing this song, or we hear this song. If you need Jesus in your life, then I'd like to invite you to come right now and just find your way to this altar of prayer. It's all ready for you. Jesus is all ready for you. And the only way you can come is just as you are. If you need Him, just step out and make your way to the altar of prayer. Claim Him as Savior today.
John for a powerful message. It's possible that someone watching from home this day has been moved. I hope that you have taken the time to bow down wherever you are, maybe in your living room or somewhere if you're out and about in another place, but I hope you have opened your heart to Jesus today. Because really, this is what it's all about. And we all here love the Lord, and it's my prayer that all of us will share our faith, share our story with as many as we can. So we're going to close out this service with a prayer, and as we join our hearts in prayer, if you at home have made a decision for Christ, let us know that we might be in prayer with you and help you to get started on this journey of faith. So will you pray with me today? Oh, gracious God, we thank you for this wonderful service, for this powerful message, calling us to a saving relationship with you. Lord, we believe that you are the way, the truth, and the life. And whenever we put our faith and trust in you, we can be assured that you will lead us down the right path. Now, Lord, it's my sincere prayer that perhaps someone watching this day has made a commitment to you. And if so, Lord, let them share that with us, that we might be in prayer for them and help them to get started in this journey of faith. Now go with us and keep us until we meet again, and may our hearts be filled with your love. And because our hearts are filled with your love, may we share our faith with as many as possible so that others can know you as well. And all this we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.